Good day guys. Today we are going to talk about nasal polyp, which is a very important topic and may come as essay for third year MBBS. What is a nasal polyp? Nasal polyp are just non-neoplastic masses of edematous nasal mucosa or sinus mucosa. So they are just non-neoplastic masses. Now we can talk about the two varieties of nasal polyp. One is endoclonal and then bilateral ethmoidal polyp. First, we can talk about endoclonal polyp. Endoclonal polyp has two words, andro and clonal. Andro means maxillary antrum and clonal means nasopharynx of the posterior nose. So it arises from maxillary antrum and it has three parts. First one is from antrum, that is maxillary antrum, and then clonal part and nasal part that makes the whole a trilobed polyp. So we can say the endoclonal polyp arises from maxillary antrum and it is a trilobed one. Next we can talk about the etiology of endoclonal polyp. Even though the exact cause is unknown, mostly nasal allergy coupled with sinus infection is the mostly seen cause, and it usually occurs in children and young adults, which is seen as single and unilateral. Usually they are single and unilateral. Next we can talk about the symptoms of nasal polyp. As we said, unilateral, there will be unilateral nasal obstruction and there will be voice change. The voice will be thick and dull because of hyponasality. Hyponasality occurs because of this nasal obstruction. There will be less air passes through the nose. Next will be nasal discharge, which is mucoid in nature. So the symptoms are unilateral nasal obstruction, voice change and nasal discharge. Obstruction may become bilateral if the polyp grows larger into the nasopharynx. Now let us talk about the signs of endoclonal polyp. The polyp will be large, smooth, and it is grayish mass. Okay, this is the most important point here. It will be seen as grayish mass covered with nasal discharge. You have to remember the color of the polyp, which is grayish mass usually. And it is soft to touch and movable with a probe. We can move it to up and down with a probe. And if it is larger than usually seen, then it will be seen as pink congested one. Usually it will be grayish mass. Investigations. We use rhinoscopy and endoscopy. As the endoclonal polyp grows posteriorly, it is often missed in anterior rhinoscopy but is often clearly seen in posterior rhinoscopy and endoscopy. In posterior rhinoscopy, we can see the globular mass in nasopharynx, and in endoscopy, we can see the polyp posteriorly in the nasal cavity. Next, we can talk about the differential diagnosis. First one is a blob of mucus which looks like polyp but will disappear on blowing. Second one is hypertrophied middle turbinate. And the third one is angiofibroma and other neoplasms other than angiofibroma. Next, we can talk about the treatment of endoclonal polyp. The treatment of choice, or TOC as I mentioned here, is endoscopic sinus surgery, or FESS. What is FESS? Functional endoscopic sinus surgery. It is the new name for endoscopic sinus surgery. But in earlier cases, we used simple polyectomy and Caldwell look operation for recurrent cases. But in endoscopic sinus surgery, we remove the polyp completely. So for complete removal, we use this endoscopic sinus surgery. In recurrent cases, we use the term Caldwell look operation if the case is recurrent, but most commonly nowadays it is not recurrent because of endoscopic sinus surgery where we completely remove the polyp. But these days endoscopic sinus surgery has superseded other modes of polyp removal like Caldwell look operation. Next we can talk about bilateral ethmoidal polyp. The etiology of bilateral ethmoidal polyp is very complex and not very well understood. The first one is rhinosinusitis, disorders of ciliary motility and cystic fibrosis. Next, we can talk about the disease associated with bilateral ethmoidal polyp. First one is chronic rhinosinusitis. Even if it is allergic or non-allergic sinusitis, we can see polyp there. Next is asthma. 7% of patients with asthma has polyps. Next is aspirin intolerance. 36% of patients with aspirin intolerance show polyp. Cystic fibrosis due to abnormal mucosa, it shows. And the next is allergic fungal sinusitis. We have Cartagena syndrome, Young syndrome and Chark-Strauss syndrome. A syndrome is a group of symptoms, as we all know. Cartagena syndrome consists of the following symptoms. The first one is bronchiectasis, sinusitis also, bronchiectasis, sinusitis, situs inversus. What is situs inversus? It is the failure of inversion of internal organs. Okay, and the CD is ciliary dyskinesis. Situs inversus is the failure of rotation of internal organs in fetal period. Next is Young's syndrome. Young's syndrome consists of sinopulmonary disease and azoospermia. Young's syndrome consists of sinopulmonary disease and azoospermia. Next is Churg-Strauss syndrome. Churg-Strauss syndrome, it consists of many asthma, fever, eosinophilia, vasculitis and granuloma. Just we can make a mnemonic for this. Just write FAV example, FAV and EG for example. Churg-Strauss syndrome is a new word, Churg-Strauss syndrome. So we are writing that it is our favorite example. So we can just write FAV and EG. Fever, asthma, V for vasculitis and E for eosinophilia and G for granuloma. Another disease seen associated is nasal mastocytosis. It is a form of chronic rhinitis. It is a form of chronic rhinitis in which the nasal mucosa is infiltrated with mast cells. Okay, mast cells is more abundant than eosinophils. Eosinophils will be there, but it is very few. And therefore, IgE levels will be normal and skin test for allergy, all those will be normal. This is all about disease associated. Next, we can talk about the pathogenesis of endocrinal polyp. Extracellular fluid collection will be there. Nasal mucosa, particularly in the region of middle meatus and turbinate, to form edematous, it become edema and there happens polypoidal changes. And this polyp will be sessile in the beginning and then it become pedunculated due to gravity and excessive sneezing. Gravity and excessive sneezing. These are the two reasons why it become pedunculated later. Early it will be sessile in nature. Next we can talk about the pathology. Pathology means simply histology of the cells there. In early stages, surface of this nasal polyp will be normal as that of nasal mucosa. What is the normal cells? This is simply ciliated columnar epithelium. Here I failed to draw the cilia. So this is the normal. Then it becomes squamous cells. Why squamous cells? This metaplastic change to transitional cells and also squamous type. Transitional cells and also squamous type. Why? There happens metaplasia, maybe because on the exposure to atmospheric irritation. Atmospheric irritation will make this metastatic changes from ciliated columnar epithelium to transitional and also squamous type. It is due to atmospheric irritation. Exposure to atmospheric irritation. And also the submucosa shows large intercellular spaces which is filled with serous fluid. Which is filled with serous fluid. There is also infiltration with eosinophils and round cells. Next we can talk about site of origin. This usually arises from the lateral wall of the nose, usually from the middle turbinate. Middle turbinate means the most common sites are uncinate process, bulla ethmoidalis, ostea of sinuses, medial surface and edge of medial turbinate. I am drawing the turbinates. These are turbinates removed, turbinates reflected, just to show you the bulla ethmoidalis and ostea of sinuses. I am reflecting superior, middle and inferior turbinates. And this is the normal position, how it looks like in an anatomical position, in a normal person. And in middle turbinate, there is an extra or a long process and this is known as uncinate process. This is how normally turbinates look like. Bulla ethmoidalis is present in the middle turbinate, below the middle turbinate, and there is ostea of sinus also. Let me show you. I'm just rubbing how the middle turbinate, and I'm just trying to show you that after reflecting the middle turbinate, I am here reflecting the middle turbinate to show you the bulla ethmoidalis. This is a protrusion known as bulla ethmoidalis under the middle turbinate.
And this is hiatus semilunaris.
There are openings. This is the opening of maxillary sinus, accessory maxillary sinus and ethmoidal, frontal, middle ethmoidal sinus opening. And in the superior turbinate, we have two openings of posterior ethmoid sinus, and here we have opening of nasal acrimal duct. This is the view of opening of sinus, and also medial surface and edge of middle turbinate. This is the medial surface and edge. That means usually the middle turbinate and also the structures behind it. This is a figure. You can see sphenoidal air sinus, also posterior ethmoidal sinus, middle ethmoidal sinus,
anterior ethmoidal sinus also you can see, and in hiatus semilunaris you can see the maxillary sinus opening. Here you can see the hiatus semilunaris, that frontal sinus opening, and this is the overview of the lateral wall of nose. Next, we can talk about symptoms, signs and complications. It can be seen in any age but mostly seen in adult. The presenting symptom is nasal stuffiness that lead to nasal obstruction. There will be loss of sense of smell partially or total, and also headache due to associated sinusitis, sneezing and nasal discharge due to associated allergy. Usually the nasal discharge will be watery in nature, and this is due to associated allergy. And also we can find that mass or the polyp protruding from the nostril. This is all about symptoms. Next, the signs. Here the doctor sees the polyps by doing investigations like anterior rhinoscopy or endoscopy. The polyp here will be smooth, glistening and pale in color, and also grape-like masses. And the polyp will be usually sessile or pedunculated. In both forms it can be seen, and it is insensitive. And also it will not bleed on touch, and are insensitive to probing. It occurs, that is the polyp usually occurs as multiple polyps and also bilateral. Next, we can talk about the complications. Complications means during long standing cases there will be broadening of nose. Okay, broadening of nose means the nose will expand because of the polyp inside. Let me draw something like it looks like a nose. Let this be the nasal septum, and this is the normal position, and here there will be broadening of nose, and the distance, that is intercandle distance, will be increased intercandle distance. Next, diagnosis or simple investigations. Diagnosis can be easily made from clinical examination, and then the second one is computer tomography or simply CT. The scan of paranasal sinus is essential to exclude the bony erosion, and also histology to if we suspect any neoplasm or all, and the CT help us to plan surgery also. Next, we can talk about the treatment. There is both conservative treatment and also surgical treatment. So first we can talk about conservative treatment. There is antihistaminics for the first time. There is early polypoidal changes can be treated by antihistaminics, that is edematous and all. If it fails, then we can give steroids for short course. Steroids in the form of spray like budesonide, beclomethasone, etc. The contraindications of using steroids as a conservative treatment is that if the patient has hypertension or PUD or peptic ulcer disease or DA or diabetes mellitus, or if the patient is pregnant or if the patient has TB, you should not use steroids as a conservative treatment. Next, we can talk about the surgical treatment. It is same as androcoanal polyp endoscopic sinus surgery, or FESS. What is FESS? Functional endoscopic sinus surgery, which is same as what we saw in androcoanal nasal polyp removal. Here different types or various types of endoscopes are used, which are 0 degree, 30 degree or 70 degree angulated. And here we can polyp can be removed more accurately when ethmoid cells are removed. And before doing FESS or endoscopic sinus surgery, the following four surgeries we should perform. And the first one is polypectomy. Polypectomy is the simple or the general method we use for any polyp. Then we have intranasal, extranasal and transcentral ethmoidectomy. In intranasal ethmoidectomy, the root will be intranasal. For uncapping of the ethmoidal air cells, we use intranasal root. The next is extranasal ethmoidectomy. If the polyp recur after intranasal procedures and the surgical landmarks are ill-defined, okay? And next is transcentral ethmoidectomy.
Here the antrum is opened by Caldwell look approach. Let us have a talk on the important points so far, the points to remember. The first point, if the polyp appear red and fleshy, friable. If the polyp appear red and fleshy, it also friable and has granular surface, especially in older patients, then we have to think of malignancy. There is a chance for malignancy in such a presentation. The second point states that underneath a simple nasal polyp there will be a malignancy, and therefore all the simple nasal polyp should be subjected to histology. Histology will reveal that if there is malignancy underneath. The third point, that a simple polyp in a child may be anything. Maybe it can be a glioma in the first place, or it can be an encephalocele, or it can be a meningoencephalocele. So it can be anything like glioma, encephalocele or meningoencephalocele. So the simple polyp should always be aspirated and the fluid should be examined for CSF. And careless removal of such a polyp, if the CSF was there, will result in CSF rhinorrhea or meningitis. These are the complications if there is careless removal of such a polyp. Next, the fourth point deals with multiple nasal polyp in children. Multiple nasal polyp. If there is multiple nasal polyp, it is usually associated with mucoviscidosis. Mucoviscidosis or cystic fibrosis. Mucoviscidosis is another name of cystic fibrosis, usually associated with multiple nasal polyp in children. It is also known as cystic fibrosis. Next, we can talk about the fifth point, where it deals with epistasis and orbital symptoms. If there is bleeding, what is epistasis? There is bleeding from the nose and also orbital symptoms, and then it is associated with polyp. Okay, if there is associated polyp with epistasis and also orbital symptoms, we should always arouse the suspicion of malignancy. And this is all about polyp. Thank you.